All right. Are we ready? All right, we're ready. Okay. Ooh, okay. Ready for our solid lesson on P divisible groups. Okay. So I'd better motivate. So from last time, we considered modular curves of the form Y of gamma, and we considered them over the base W. Like W is like the vit vectors in FP bar, say. But you can think of it as just ZP if you like. And we were interested in these sorts of local rings, O, Y of gamma, and X, completed, where X lies in Y of gamma, and it is a point defined over FP bar. I mean, that was the main object of interest for this course. And maybe I'll even draw some sort of picture the way that Frank did. I want the thing to not include the cusp, so maybe I'll do something like that. So infinity is kind of out here. It's not in y of gamma, and maybe the thing has a few holes like this, or something like this. And so this is a rather crude picture of y of gamma, kind of as a p-adic object. And in completing with respect to the ideal cut out by this x, that's sort of like isolating a little disk inside. In fact, this literally is Frank's picture if x is one of the super singular points of y of gamma mod p, right? And this local ring, you should think of it, O, y, gamma, x, is like functions on this region right here. Of course, the neighborhood that I drew really seems like a disk, and it really will be so if x is ordinary, or if p does not divide the level of gamma. On the other hand, if p does divide the level of gamma and x is supersingular, you expect something a little more complicated than a disk, and that would account for the fact that this guy is no longer simply a power series ring, right? And, okay, so more about that region. That region is the region where the elliptic curve, when you take it mod p, you basically get x. So, okay, that's sort of a strange thing to say. So this x thing corresponded to an elliptic curve, maybe with some extra level structure, who knows. But maybe that elliptic curve is E0. So now I can say E mod p is E0. So the setup is like this. We chose from the beginning an elliptic curve over FP bar, and now we're considering the region where of the modular curve where the elliptic curve mod p is E0. In other words, this is a deformation problem for E0. How do we deform E0 up to, say, characteristic 0, right? And the lesson for today is this. It's to deform E0 is to deform its p-divisible group. So the p-divisible group is E0 p infinity like this. So what is this object? And what is this theorem? So this is called the Serre-Tate theorem, or it follows from the Serre-Tate theorem. So that's the general outline of what we're going to do today. So we reduce our problem of this local ring to something about studying p-divisible groups and their deformations. All right, so a little primer. P-divisible groups are built out of group schemes, so why don't we just review those? So let's say S is a scheme. And I define this way, a group scheme is, well, it's a scheme, G over S, just a morphism of schemes, together with structure which makes it look like a group. So there is a composition law like this, G cross G over S to G, and this is supposed to be an S morphism, and this represents multiplication. Maybe I'll even draw it. There's supposed to be an identity. The identity is a point of G, but it's an S point, which means it's like a section from S to G. And then, of course, groups have inverses, so that's going to have an inverse map from G to G. So all of these have to be S morphisms. And that's all. I mean, you can add whatever adjectives to the scheme you want and get, you know, it could be a finite scheme, and then you call it a finite group scheme, stuff like that. All right, so this definition is slightly dry, but it comes to life when you consider the functor of points of G. So, functor of points. So the idea is this. Plug in a scheme over S, outcomes an actual honest group. So for some morphism, T to S of whatever type, you get what I'll call G of T. And these are the S morphisms from T into G. Okay, right. So they are the kind of T-valued points of G. And just formally, what you can do is use mu to get a group structure on this guy, right? If you've got a map from G cross G to G, then you get a map from G of T cross G of T to G of T. And that turns G of T into a group. So G is really a functor from schemes over S to groups. And no information is lost when you pass from the point of view of G as a group scheme to the point of view of G is a functor from S schemes to groups, as long as you know that this functor is representable. This functor is representable by the group scheme G. So I could have equivalently defined a group scheme to be such a functor which is representable. So we take a kind of schizophrenic point of view. G is at one hand a group, a scheme with these composition laws, and it's also this functor. Okay. So this is a very important point of view to have going forward. All right, here come the examples. So all of these are group schemes over Z, or spec Z, right? So the first example you get is the additive group, GA. So GA is a scheme, it is spec polynomial ring in one variable. And rather than write for you three morphisms like this, I'll just describe the functor of points. So I can just say GA of any Z algebra R, that is any ring R, will just be R itself under addition. You see, Homs from ZT into R are just like, you know, where does T go? So you give an element of R. And so, you know, set theoretically is just R, and we declare that the group structure is just addition. And similarly, we have the multiplicative group GM, that's spec ZT1 over T. And GM of R, if you imagine this ring mapping into R, T has to go somewhere, T inverse have to go somewhere, they have to multiply to 1. So the image of T has to be a unit, so you get R cross, and this is under multiplication. Yeah. Okay. So those are very basic p-divisible groups, group schemes, getting ahead of myself. And another thing I can do, which is kind of silly, is to take G, any abstract group, and just, I'm going to underline it, and that'll be the constant group scheme. And this is supposed to be just a bunch of spec Zs, one for every element of G. And G underline of R, you know, it's called the constant group scheme because it has this property that you just get G so long as spec R is connected. Okay. Right, the constant group scheme. Okay. So additive, multiplicative, and constant. And then there's one more I'm going to add to this list of group schemes over Z, and this is a very important one. It's the group scheme of nth roots of unity. And so this will be the kind of the last time I draw it out as an affine scheme like this, but it's, it should be a capital N, like that, right? So mu n of R, well, this is actually naturally a subgroup scheme of GM. It's the n torsion inside of GM. Namely, it's the group of nth roots of unity, so x in R. N equals 1. So there you go. Okay. Very nice. So mu n is maybe the first interesting one I've written down, really. And its behavior is very sensitive to whether n is invertible on the base. So of course, n is not invertible in Z, but I could pass to some algebra R where n is invertible. So if R is a Z 1 over n algebra, then mu capital N, you know, I base change the thing to R, and I get a new group scheme. This time it's over R. And if N is invertible, well, this isn't going to be constant necessarily, but it's kind of the next best thing. This is called étale. And what does étale mean? It means that this becomes isomorphic to a constant group scheme after passing to an étale extension. extension of R. So in this case, you can just take R and add nth roots of unity. And if n is invertible in R, adding nth roots of unity defines an étale that is unramified extension. We kind of know that from number theory. So when you add roots of unity here, you can just do a little change of variable and move them away, and then you just are stuck with the constant root scheme. So mu and r basically becomes constant after you pass to an étale extension, so we just call it étale. Okay, so I said that mu n was very sensitive to the base and whether n was invertible, so let's just go over to the other extreme. If, let's say, n is a prime number, and I consider mu p over fp, this is certainly not étale. There's no étale extension of fp that you get, where you see p distinct roots of unity. So, in fact, if I draw out mu p like this, I mean, it's spec over fp. It's spec fp adjoin x modulo x to the p minus 1, right? Just on the pattern as over there. Of course, this is the same as x minus 1 to the p. And this is just, you know, it's a local ring. That's just one point, right? It's fp adjoin something which is nilpotent. So this is just one point. It's connected as a topological space. So we say that mu p over fp is connected. Okay. And so I think you should think of étale and connected as sort of two opposite poles of behavior that a group scheme could be having. Connected, all the points are sort of stuck together. You can't pass to some field extension of fp where the pth roots of unity separate apart. It's never going to happen. But over z1 over p, for instance, you can add some pth roots of unity to that, that's étale, and then you get p distinct pth roots of unity. So étale versus connected. All right. Yes, and of course, another great example of a way to get group schemes is to take an elliptic curve and consider its n torsion. Okay. So whenever E is an elliptic curve over R, you get a group scheme E of n, and this is a special kind of group scheme called a finite flat group scheme over R. Actually, mu n is also a finite and flat group scheme over R as well. And, well, what else can I say about it? This is étale if n is invertible in R. Right, so it actually rather works similarly to the case of mu n. Mu n is the n torsion in an algebraic group GM, and it's étale if n is invertible. En is the n torsion in an algebraic group E, and E of n is étale if n is invertible once again. I guess one other thing I can say is that if you take an elliptic curve over fp, or fp bar or something, this is never étale. So it is never étale. It might be connected if E is supersingular. Yeah. So it's rather sensitive to what E is, but it will never be étale. All right, great. And also, when it comes to finite flat group schemes, we have a notion of Cartier duality. And here's the setup. If you have some finite flat group scheme over some base, well, there's a notion of duality for it. You can pass from G to its dual group. And the dual group is going to be something, I'm not going to prove its existence, but the dual group does this. I mean, I'm going to describe it on it as its functor of points. When you plug in a T, well, I expect a group to come out of this. And it's going to be Hom's in the category of group schemes over T from G base change to T into the multiplicative group GMT, like so. So in its way, it's sort of like Pontryag and duality for groups. You know, you pass from one group to another, and you take Hom's from it into, well, this is something like a group of roots of unity, something like that. And this is best demonstrated with some examples here. So if I take, for instance, the constant group scheme Z mod NZ, underline it, right? and I dualize that, you get mu n. And this is a very typical sort of behavior. Cartier duality exchanges constant with multiplicative. By multiplicative, I mean something like mu n. Of course, it's a subgroup scheme of multiplicative group. Okay. So Cartier duality exchanges multiplicative mu n with constant. On the other hand, what is Cartier dual to E of n, this finite flat group scheme? In this case, you just get E of n once again. That is, E of n is auto-dual. And this is a pretty important point. This is in reference to the they pairing on an elliptic curve. So the reason we have this auto-duality is because we've got a pairing from En cross En into mu n. Okay. And this has this nice property that if you kind of fix a point here, you get homomorphisms from En to mu n. And the only such are given by points of this E of n. So that's what sets it's. That's equivalent to saying that E of n is its own dual. Okay. All right, good. All right, so while we're talking about elliptic curves, when you have an elliptic curve, you get a whole family of finite flat group schemes, these E of n's, and I'm going to be interested in the situation where n is a power of p. And in that case, you get a whole family of p power finite flat group schemes, and they are arranged like this. So we're interested in the system. EP, so this is inside of EP squared, inside of EP cubed, and so forth. Okay, so we have this growing tower of finite flat group schemes, and these constitute a P divisible group. The whole system is a P divisible group. Okay. All right, so I'd better say exactly what that is. So here's the definition. So let's suppose P is prime. And let's also fix an integer H, at least one. And let's say R is a ring. And I define this, a P divisible group over R of height H. Is a directed system. All right, so it's a collection of arrows like this, but I also write the thing as a forward limit, like so, and then I also write the thing as just G. So I can refer to the whole thing with one letter G. So I index them like this. The whole system is used to refer to the P divisible group. And what are these Gn? So Gn is a P torsion commutative finite flat group scheme over R there's some conditions attached which makes the thing look like this scenario over here. So first of all, I want to get this height h involved. So these are all supposed to be locally free of rank p to the n times h. So gn here is supposed to be locally free over r of rank p to the n h. You think about e of p to the n over here as being local, you know, it should be locally free of rank what? P to the 2n. I mean, it's supposed to capture the notion that this thing kind of wants to have p to the 2n points in it. So this thing sort of wants to have p to the nh points in it. But that's very informal because maybe it's a supersingular elliptic curve over fp and it has zero points, zero physical points. But as a geometric object, the group scheme has this rank. Okay. And then the final condition is that gn maps to gn plus 1 is supposed to give you an isomorphism. These aren't isomorphic, but you get an isomorphism from Gn onto the p to the n torsion inside of Gn plus 1. So this map is supposed to factor through this map, and you get an isomorphism. So that is G1 is the p torsion in G2, G2 is the p squared torsion in G3, and so forth. Okay. All right, so there's a lot of conditions here, and it's rather confusing, but let's just get the basic. I mean, I find with this thing, the best thing to do is to just study the examples. So the basic examples are these. Well, the first example is the constant, not very interesting group scheme, QP mod ZP. And this thing, as an abstract group, has the property of being P divisible as an abstract group. Any element of QP mod ZP, you can divide it by P. Not necessarily uniquely, but something that multiplies to P gives you every. That is, multiplication by P on this thing is surjective. And this thing is supposed to represent the limit as n goes to infinity. It's a forward limit of, well, I'll write it this way, 1 over P to the n, z, modulo z, that constant group scheme there. Yeah. And this thing has height 1, right? So this thing is going to be free, literally free, of rank P to the n. And so the h here in this situation is 1. And so there's a height, so that's sort of a straightforward quantity associated to a p-divisible group. There's another quantity, the dimension, which I'm going to associate, and we will talk about it later, but I'm going to leave it undefined for now. And I will just say that this thing has dimension 0, as it should, because it's just a cluster of points. That is, 1 over p to the n z mod z is just point, 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 point. It has 0 dimension. Mu p infinity is the next one, and this is the limit, forward limit of the mu p to the n's, of course. And this has height 1 and dimension 1, right? So there's a little, there's something connected about the p to the n, mu p to the n's. The way you see that it's dimension 1 is that it's the p torsion, the p power torsion inside of an algebraic group, namely gm of dimension 1. And so the dimension of the algebraic group lends itself to the dimension of the p divisible. Again, I haven't actually defined dimension yet. So must be taken with a grain of salt. And then finally, if I have an abelian variety, of course this is this collection like this. And let's suppose that the dimension of A is G. Then in this situation, the dimension is G to match the dimension of the abelian variety, but the height is 2G. It's picking up the fact that this AP to the n wants to have P to the 2GN points. Okay. Just like an elliptic curve, EP to the n wants to have P to the 2N points. Okay. Great. All right, so there you have it. This is the category of P divisible groups over some base. And, as with elliptic curves, you can study them basically for your entire life. There is a very rich structure to it. But you should not spend your entire life studying p-divisible groups over a perfect field, because that is solved already. It's a very, very rich category over whatever base. Maybe the base is ZP, maybe the base is something more complicated. You can consider them in families, but over a point, which is a perfect field in characteristic P, the category is completely described, and I will tell you about that now. Okay. So let's say K is a perfect field in characteristic. Yeah, perfect field in characteristic P. Okay. And so P divisible groups over K are classified by certain linear algebra objects called Dyodonné modules. So here's the thing. So we have this ring W of K, and this is the ring of Witt vectors, and this has the property that it's a DVR, and when you mod it by P, you just get K itself. And now I'll tell you what a Dyodonné module is. So a Dyodonné module is a free W of K of rank, well, some finite rank, call it H, together with two operators. So let me call the thing M. and these satisfy certain properties. They're not supposed to be W of K linear. So let me say such that. So we have this Frobenius endomorphism of K. So actually it's an automorphism because K is a perfect field. And X goes to just X to the D. And the formation of Witt vectors is functorial. So if you've got an automorphism of K, you get an automorphism of Witt vectors of K. And now with this in hand, I can tell you what F and V are supposed to satisfy. F is supposed to be sigma linear. V is sigma inverse linear. That is, it passes constant out with a sigma attached. And FV equals P. Okay. So in brief, a Dieudonné module is a free Witt vector module together with these two semilinear operators. If K happened to be as simple as FP, if K is just FP, then W is ZP. And there is no Frobenius automorphism, it's just the identity. And so you're just talking about two operators where F, the product is P, that's all. So, or maybe it's just one operator and has to divide P, and then V is the quotient. Okay. And what's nice about Dieudonné modules is that you get an equivalence of categories. So there exists an equivalence of categories. From G to M of G. Oh, I should really say it's an anti-equivalence, right? Because it's supposed to, it turns arrows the other way. It's contravariant. And it has the following properties. So this is an equivalence category between P divisible groups over K and Dieudonné modules. And this has the following property. So first of all, the height of the p-divisible group is just measured by the rank of M of G. So whatever the rank, this is a free module over the Witt vectors, and so that's supposed to give you just the height. The dimension of G, that which I didn't quite explain, is the dimension as a k-vector space of M of G modulo F. So whatever the image of F is, you mod out by that. Since F divides P, P times M is contained in F times M. So this thing, P is zero in it, so it's a k-vector space. And now you can detect various features of the p-divisible group from its Dieudonné module. One thing is that G is connected if and only if let's suppose you keep applying F over and over and over again. You expect what's going to happen is that you get something closer and closer to zero. That is, Fn, the image of it, is supposed to be contained within P times M of G for n large enough. And another way of saying this is that the operator F should be topologically nilpotent. Applying F brings you closer to zero, bit by bit. And I kind of said that these were sort of lying on opposite poles connected in a tall. So the opposite of this happening would be that F is invertible. Okay. Right. All right, so we've got this nice equivalence of categories. It's time to talk about the examples. So, all right, so for the constant group scheme, M of QP mod ZP, well, let's just work over K equals FP. Let's do that. So in this case, you just get ZP. So W of K here, ZP. So you get a free module of rank 1, and I have to tell you how F and V act. So this guy, it's a tall, so F should be invertible. I can just set F to be 1 and V to be P, and that's it. So that's the most basic example. So F being invertible, F being 1, is telling you that you have something atall. In fact, this one is constant. m of mu p infinity. Okay, so that's also rank 1, which we expect because the thing is height 1. But this time, f should act topologically nilpotently. In fact, the only way that's going to happen in this scenario is that f is just p and v is 1. Notice that you see the dimension coming out of this because zp modulo pzp has dimension 1 and mu p infinity has dimension 1. Okay. All right, so that is what it is. More exciting things happen if you consider an elliptic curve over K. K is supposed to be a perfect field. Let's just say K is algebraically closed. It might make our lives easier. Well, so E gives me a P divisible group. And I can take its student A module, and I get something of dimension 2, that is rank 2 over the vit vectors. So if this is going to be W of K twice. But how F acts, well, there's a little leeway here. So what do I know about this thing? This thing has height 2 and dimension 1, and that puts certain restrictions on the behavior of F. And this is a really wonderful exercise, but F has to act kind of in one of two ways. You can change you can change coordinates on this thing so that one of the following things happens. I can write down the matrix of F. It will be 1P, or it will be this matrix, 1P. So notice, okay, these matrices act rather differently. In this scenario right here, F ends up being topologically nilpotent. If you square this matrix, you get the scalar P. And so just squaring it gives you P. And therefore, by this condition, G would have to be connected. So this thing would be connected. And that corresponds exactly to the case that E is supersingular. In this case, E is ordinary. And in the ordinary case, you have kind of P torsion points, P torsion points. And so somehow it's sort of half atoll and half connected. And actually, what's going on here is that here F is really the direct sum of the identity operator with P. And so it's actually going to be the direct sum of this Frobenius with this Frobenius. And so that means in the ordinary case, EP infinity is just the direct sum, QP mod ZP plus mu P infinity. So we have a complete understanding of what a p-divisible group is over a perfect field. And we can apply this to the situation of modular curves. We kind of started with an elliptic curve in characteristic p, and we're considering how to deform it to characteristic 0. And so the main principle here is that to deform an elliptic curve, it's enough to deform its p-divisible group. I'll tell you about the Serre tape theorem. And the subtitle would be How to Deform E over FP to E over ZP. Maybe I like to put a little zero here. So kind of what is the kind of deformation space? What is the parameter space for the problem of taking an elliptic curve over FP and turning it into an E over ZP? Or maybe something more complicated than ZP, but that's just the thing to keep in mind. Okay. And the idea is this. To give an E over ZP, it is only necessary to give the reduction of E mod P, E tensor FP. It's only necessary to give the reduction and EP infinity, the P divisible group. Over ZP like this. So if you want to construct E over ZP, it's a Weierstrass equation or whatever, It's enough to give whatever that Weierstrass equation is modulo p, together with the isomorphism class of this p divisible group over zp. And those two pieces of data determine what the Weierstrass equation is over zp. So this is a bit of a miracle that says that to deform E0, it's enough just to deform the p divisible group. All right, and now I've got to be a little more specific about what I mean by everything. So let's say R. All right, so in setting up a deformation problem, the following is a very common thing to be doing. You can consider just Artinian local rings. And let's say M is its maximal ideal. And let's say that R modulo M is FP bar, say. And I'm interested in the following category, LR, the category of elliptic curves over R, right? Basically, I've got to compare this category to the category LFP bar, right? And so here's the thing. I'm going to consider this alternate category, AR, which are just these, pairs of these data. So AR is going to be this. It's the category of triples, not pairs, but triples, actually, E0, G, and iota, where E0 is an elliptic curve over FP bar, G is a P divisible group over R, and iota is a piece of data which compares the two things, right? If you've got this elliptic curve, of course, the p divisible group of this guy ought to be this guy modulo p, and that's what this iota is telling you. It's going to be an isomorphism between the p divisible group attached to the elliptic curve mod p and G modulo M, like this, right? Right, so G was P divisible over R. When you base change it to FP bar, you get a P divisible group over FP bar, and that's what this thing is. So if I didn't have this iota, it would just be pairs, elliptic curve over FP bar, and P divisible group. But if this thing is supposed to come from something over R, there'd better be this compatibility where these guys are isomorphic, and I'm including the isomorphism in the data defining this category. So AR is the category of isomorphism classes of triples like this. I said it's a category, so I've got to define morphisms, but I'll just do it. I'm not going to write it down. I'll just say it's just going to be a map from E0 to the other guy, from G to the other guy, that makes the diagram with the iotas commute. All right, so now we've got this morphism, this functor from LR to AR. And this takes E to the triple. So, of course, the first thing I'm expecting is an elliptic curve over FP bar. So, of course, I get this guy. And then the second thing I want is a P divisible group. So I get this guy. And then the third thing is supposed to be an isomorphism between this thing mod P and the P divisible group of this guy. But they're kind of canonically the same thing anyway, so this is just the identity. Good. This is an equivalence of categories, so this is the Serre-Tate theorem. Okay. All right, so the idea being that to give an elliptic curve, it's just necessary to give E mod P and a P divisible group, so long as those things are comparable. All right, so this really, this tool really enables us to study that local ring, which is sort of the whole point of this lecture series. It has to do with a deformation problem for P divisible groups rather than a deformation problem of elliptic curves. Okay. So the following proposition, the proof of it is outlined in the notes, so I'll just quote it now. All right, so let's let W just be the vit vectors of FP bar. And I'm going to give you a category C, the category of complete local noetherian W algebras whose residue field is FP bar. Residue field FP bar. That's that category. So this is kind of typical for setting up a deformation problem. You've got some object over FP bar. You want to deform it up to, well, before it was Artinian rings, and now we're going a step further. We want complete local rings. And the other setup here is that let's say x is a point of y1 of n. So here's this. So here's e0p. Nope, not y naught, y1, right? So y1 of n classifies elliptic curves together with a point of order n. So let's say e naught capital P is one of those. And now I have a functor from C to sets. And this functor does the following thing. It takes R to the set of pairs G, comma, iota. Where, what's G? So G is a p-divisible group over R. And iota is the thing which gives G some chance of being the p-divisible group associated to an elliptic curve, namely to this elliptic curve. So I have this fixed elliptic curve to work with here. So let's take its p-divisible group. And iota is supposed to be an isomorphism between that and G tensor FP bar, right? G is over R. When I tensor it over R with FP bar, I get a p-divisible group over FP bar, and iota is an isomorphism here. Okay. All right, so this F is a deformation problem for the p-divisible group, this guy, E naught, P infinity. How to lift this guy. So in light of the Serre-Tate theorem, lifting this guy ought to have something to do with lifting the elliptic curve E0. But you're lifting it only, I mean, it can only be an elliptic curve whose reduction is E0. And so it should have something to do with the neighborhood of the modular curve around that point X. So the theorem is that this is representable by the complete local ring O, Y1 of N, X. Okay. So this gives an interpretation for that completed local ring. It's the deformation ring for the p-divisible group E0, P infinity. Okay. And we're in a nice situation where this level structure, oh, I didn't say it, but P does not divide N. You know, kind of for the whole talk, P didn't divide N, and that is still in effect. So, okay. So we were in one of these situations where Y1 of N modulo P was smooth. And so this is a complete local ring of a variety at a smooth point. So in fact, this thing is nothing but W, power series in one variable. So in this case, at least, you get something very, very easy. But notice that, I mean, so that's something just, you need a little more to know this. But for this, just notice that it basically didn't have much to do with E0 at all. It only had to do with this. And then another thing you should notice, which maybe is a little confusing, is that where did this other P go? So that capital P kind of has nothing to do with anything. It's just along for the ride. It really, the whole purpose of it was to rigidify the situation so that this modular curve actually existed and was, you know, represented the functor it's supposed to represent. It disappears in this formulation. Okay. So, wonderful. So. Ah, right, so this shifts the focus from elliptic curves over to p-divisible groups. And so that's going to be the focus of study for the next two lectures. So next time, we need to pay special attention to the situation where E0 is super singular. And this guy is connected. And in this world, a connected p-divisible group is often called formal. That is, it is a formal group. That is, it is given by a power series law. So in the next lecture, which I think will be somewhat less dry than this one, we'll have to do with formal groups. Something very exciting to me. Okay, that's all. Thank you.